It's a great pleasure to introduce the keynote speaker of today. That is Barend Mons. I learned first time about Barend Mons when I gave a talk somewhere in Brussels, and a person, an EU officer, came to me and said, "I've heard exactly the same story 2 weeks ago," and that was by by this Barend Mons from the Netherlands, and that's where I, maybe 10 years ago or so, whatever. So then I stumbled over that name, and then I was fortunate enough to run into physically into Barend, and then we found out really that we share a lot of interest. And that we actually share also part in our education biography, because he was trained as a biologist, as I was trained as a biologist. We both ran into the problem that semantics in biology needed some structuring, some workup, and actually he founded the biosemantics group in the Netherlands and was head of that, or is head of that. He holds a professor position for biosemantics. And actually he has two affiliations with Rotterdam and with Leiden. And is there a third one? No, that's, yeah, you've been everywhere. And from time to time, actually, we meet and or come together in Brussels, for instance, at workshops where aspects of the future of knowledge sharing, for instance, and knowledge discovery are being discussed. He's also heavily involved in the e-science activities in the Netherlands and in the National Center for NBIC is National Bioinformatics Center. So basically, he's also a sort of wanderer between the worlds, because he's in bioinformatics and genome informatics stuff, in publishing. He's talking a lot to publishers. He's fighting with publishers. I think he's always constantly coming up with new ideas, crazy ideas sometimes. Yeah. at least they are really, you know, totally novel, new concepts. And that's why when we thought about organizing this conference, I thought I need to have Barend as a keynote speaker. And I'm really, really happy and glad that you accepted that invitation, Barend. I welcome you here with your talk on data stewardship for discovery. Stage is yours.
Okay, so just to introduce myself a little more than Martin did, because I switch all the time and it's not so easy. If this is actually copied for a long part, and if you were there, you will see a lot of overlap from my keynote at the Research Data Alliance, where the title was Bringing Your Data to Broadway from a Small Scale to a Very Big Scale. And my statement was that you need to do fundamental research, application-oriented research, and international collaboration to reach anything. And you have to do that in the life sciences, in our case, because we are biologists. But many of these things are also applicable in other sciences. So I also work with the Leiden Center for Data Science at the Leiden Advanced Computer Science Institute, where I'm the connector to the life sciences. I work in the eScience Center, which is the National eScience Center, as a life science integrator. DTL is the sort of successor of MBIC that Martin mentioned. MBIC has evaporated or sublimated into the Dutch Tech Center for Life Sciences, which is including a big data part that I had. And I'm the head of Elixir, the node in the Netherlands of Elixir, and therefore in the Head of Nodes Board of Elixir International. And much of what I'm going to say will be implemented in Elixir gradually to get more and more well-stewarded data. And finally, as you know, I'm not really involved in RDA in any formal way, but RDA takes all these principles and the Research Data Alliance and takes them broader. So the growth of all these data initiatives already shows that finally data get some interest from people. So it was a sort of a show for Broadway last time, and I kept some of these slides. And today I will talk about FAIR, and before people say, okay, that's his next crazy idea, a nice acronym, I will also show that I'm working on this for more than 10 years already, as Martin just said. So we have now defined things as research objects. That's anything that a researcher could be interested in. So it could be a full paper, a database, a nanopublication, an image. Anything that is subject to research would be a research object, and they should all be FAIR. What is FAIR standing for? It stands for findable, and that's different from searchable. Oh, there's Lars now, at least 1 second. Critical question at the end. Accessible, which is really different from open. I will come to that as well. Accessible under a well-defined license. Interoperable and reusable. And it sounds very obvious, but you'll see it's not that obvious after all. Specifically, because it should be for machines, not just for people. And the next point I want to illustrate during my talk is that data stewardship, and I will explain the difference with management, is not a goal in itself. We do it to have better knowledge discovery, as the first speaker already said. So, coming to the current situation, I think it is really a lot to lament and moan about, which I did a lot. So, first of all, I'll do like 5 or 6 minutes of how terrible things are. That's why the slide is black, you know, what is the black situation at the moment. Everybody wants structured data, obviously, because then machines know what to do. But nobody likes structured data entry. That's a dilemma. We hate it. We write down things. So we don't have structured data. Now, I saw a lot of talks about text mining. I've sort of quit text mining with my group. We leave that to Rotterdam. They're very much better at it. And they will spend another 5 years with 6 postdocs to go from 90% precision and recall to 91. Well, that is not really what I will concentrate on. And we are all imprisoned and kept hostage by the journal impact factor, which is the most inhibitory, single inhibitory factor for science at the moment. Because it forces us to write things down in narrative, and I will tell you later what my thoughts about these are. And then you have a whole industry, and many of the top people are here in the room, we do text mining, digging, what we buried first, but we'll see that later. So we collectively impair machine-assisted knowledge discovery by writing things down in very ambiguous language where the computer, it's a nightmare for computers. And this is not new. I said this 10 years ago. This is a paper from almost exactly 10 years ago, which gene did you mean, on ambiguity and stuff. And there I already said computational biology needs computer-readable information records. And then I used this also as an illustration of one of the things we discovered. We called it a nanopublication, where you say if you take a single assertion of subject, predicate, and object, and you store the provenance of that in the same graph, in RDF or anything, then you essentially have the smallest possible publication ever, one meaningful scientific assertion. That's a long time ago. Meanwhile, this is booming, and lots of people turn their data sets into nanopublications. Also, we just were on a Nature paper on Phantom 5, where 16 million nanopublications on transcription start sites in the genome are published. So the computer understands them, rather than losing the supplementary data. So in this particular paper, one of my most hated quotes is text mining, why bury it first in text, and then mine it again. Okay, so we should stop doing that. We should publish our data in a fair format to start with. But that is coming to some very difficult collaborations. Namely, it is not so easy to collaborate between biologists and engineers. So this is one of my favorite cartoons. It is really telling that the middle part is empty. First, we have to learn how to teach and talk each other's language. Still, I have to push my people to not write a paper to Nature Genetics or whatever and say, oh, look at these rock curves and these beautiful algorithms we developed. Oh, by the way, in the last 5 sentences, you can predict protein-protein interactions with it. So it gets rejected, of course. That is one problem. But the other problem, and that's another abyss, is what we call the curse of multidisciplinarity. If you try to get funding for something that is a connection between text mining or computer science and data science and biology, there's always a biologist in the panel who says, oh, you forgot my gene. Or the computer scientist says, I know a newer algorithm, you know. And then you get an A-, and of course you don't get funded. So we have a lot of trouble to get funding. That's my next moaning. Then the worst of all, you know, I have a few good people in my group that are real data experts, the most sexy job of the future, as we just heard. and this is a cartoon that I like a lot because it's the real situation, I cannot even keep my data experts. If somebody is really good, like Paul Groth, he goes to Elsevier, you know, because they pay a lot more money and you don't have to beg. So what happens? We stick with this situation. We're still in the pigeon age if it comes to scholar, this is a carrier pigeon age when it comes to scholar communication. And then, as Lars introduced, I think, years ago, the famous statement that the worst thing we ever come across in text mining is the so-called TLA, the three-letter acronym. And this is ADP. That's one pitch and ask the others, what does ADP stand for? And then it comes an amateur data processor. Now, that's bad. That's very bad. But the worst of all is we try to do it ourselves. So we get amateur data professors. Now, that's even worse, because biologists are terrible. They rather share their toothbrush than their gene name, unless it's the same name for a different gene. So we confuse text miners completely all the time, and that's our job, it seems. So this is a lot of lamenting, but let's also say, are there ways out? Now, let's first look at the result that we created all together, and it's our own fault. Okay, that is the next page phase. What I call the explicitome, a good biologist calls everything an ome, a genome, a proteome. So the explicitome is everything we have already asserted, said. And if you look at the single assertion, our estimate is, don't keep me to it, is that we have said about 10 to the 14th things in the life sciences, assertions. There is no triple store that can handle that, as we all know, but I'll give the good news later. We can handle it. So, how bad is the situation? Well, just give a few Elixir slides that we use all the time in Elixir. First of all, we all know that if you, the worst thing that people invented in the publishing world, or actually we did it ourselves, stupidly enough, is supplementary data. There's too many data to write about, so we have this link, and then you hope that the link is still working. Look at this graph. After a few years, even in top journals, the link is dead. And why is that? Because the data happened to be at the laptop of my PhD student. And when the student left, the data were gone. Too bad. That's the first big problem. The second problem, and this is also relating to data stewardship, of course. The second one is that we double the data in next generation sequencing now every 6 to 8 months. And we all know that Moore's law doesn't go faster than 18. So even the simple storage of these data is a big problem, let alone doing clever things with them. It's not like, oh, Moore's law will save us. No way, if we go on like this. Look at the red graph versus the straight line. So the result is really the following. We have a narrative paper. You know, we have to write that because we need an impact factor, otherwise we lose our job. And then we have an abstract, which is usually open. The paper, until recently, mostly disappeared behind a firewall. Then we have tables and figures that escape most text mining anyway, which is a nightmare, because they are TIFF or whatever. And then we have this horrible link to supplementary data. Okay, and that's what we publish. That's how we think scholarly communication can happen. Which is, of course, if you look at it from a fresh view, totally criminal. It's absurd. Why? Because in the abstract, the number of assertions that are freely sent into the ether is probably 5 or so, meaningful, new, or interesting scientific assertions. The average paper may be 500. In tables and figures, we usually can find thousands of them, like all these genes are involved in these diseases, and nicely, you can't read it as a computer. And then, of course, sometimes, as I said, in the supplementary data of the Nature paper on Phantom 5, there is 16 million nanopublications on transcription start sites and all kinds of registry elements in the genome. Now, the computer can read them as long as the link is there. So we better have good data stewardship on that. Otherwise, we lose that incredibly important information. And this is all behind firewalls. Of course, first we have the paywalls, and we see gradually a move to open access, but a lot of the legacy stuff is still behind the firewall. Then we have what I call the TIFF walls, and then we have the wall of broken links. So we have to cross all these walls to get to information, to mine it. How crazy is that? How much longer do we accept that? 95% of the explicitome escapes us when we do text mining, normal text mining. Now, in life sciences, And of course, I will illustrate that point because it's quite staggering, to a paper of Karin Verspoor and co-workers, where they looked at SNPs, the single nucleotide polymorphisms, that they could collect painstakingly over many, many databases, also locus-specific databases that are held by doctors, etc. And if they looked at the abstracts in PubMed, they could not find more than 2% of those SNP variant disease connections back by text mining. With the best text mining, Larry Hunter's tools, you know, whatever, not bad text mining. Then, surprisingly, when you go to the full text of a test set, you don't get much further than 4%. And altogether, even if they get down to all kinds of supplementary data, they cannot find back more than 50% of what they know should be there somewhere out there in the explicit dome. So it's really a very bad situation. Now, and then finally, if we find it, we get this. You know, you get information on the same gene everywhere. And everyone has his own little tool and highlights the thing in text. But that really doesn't help us in the end. And I will try to explain why. What are the major trends in e-science? We already know the enormity of the data sets. There's no way to read them or deal with them in the traditional way. Then you need massive computer analytic algorithms to see the patterns in those big data. And there is this irreversible movement towards open access, not only of the data, but also more and more of text. And actually the publishers, and I talk a lot to Elsevier and others, they actually want to expose their text as nanopublications actively now because they know they will lose otherwise. So it's not like they will go on much longer prohibiting us to mine their text. Actually, they will present their text in computer-readable format very quickly, all of them. And we need collaborative intelligence, and that is always my statement. Sorry if I upset some hardcore text miners. Let's do the last 10% by crowdsourcing, not by spending 5 more years and hundreds of PhDs to get a little bit higher precision and recall by computer. We still don't know whether the same major players in the next decade or so will be there. Because if some of these huge publishers cannot move quick enough, they will probably even actually disappear. Okay? So maybe there is lots of new companies coming up dealing with this. Now, is this one big black hole? Still a bit lamenting, I know that. But it's just the first quarter. Now I switch to more positive things. So is there just a big black hole, or is there light at the end of the tunnel? I think there is. Light at the end of the tunnel, and we are not just helplessly falling into our big data pit. I think there are some safety nets that can really save us and keep us from crashing, and that's what I will switch to now. We wrote this paper a few years ago on the value of data. I was just repeated almost the value of open data. We now have the added value of data. If you add a new data set to a big graph, what is the actual added value of that data? And it's cited a lot, and a lot of people follow this rule. And, you know, this is a sort of a dilemma. We publish that narrative should be killed in a narrative article, obviously. So at least what we did, we had this paper here that shows in a sort of nanopublication subject predicate object what is wrong. All the red predicates right now are completely damaging science. And what we say in the paper is that if you make a small change, you see hardly anything change. All the red ones disappear. And the big change, or the only real change, is here that the narrative article is now here. It's not center stage anymore, but it is supported by nanopublications or any other machine-readable representation of what is in the paper. And then suddenly all this starts to work. So we don't have to make a huge difference with the past. We don't say it's completely disruptive. Of course it will disrupt science. So what is the way out of the bottomless pit that we are trying to mine some data from is to start to make them findable for the computer, accessible for the computer under a well-defined license. So the license should also be computer readable. The computer knows whether it can access the data or not. It is interoperable, so you don't have to do 20,000 clever things to make 5 data sets talk to each other and then do your analysis. And it should be actually reusable, which is more than, oh, you're allowed to reuse it. If I have to download something and it takes 15 days, it's not reusable. Okay? So data stewardship must make data fair with the emphasis on machines, not just people, because people can essentially read everything, you know, not much of the computer language we use. That means we need to professionalize data stewardship. Don't leave it to the biologists like me. We will make, again, a mess, you know. We finally understand the value of standards, so we all create our own. That's what biologists do. So we have to educate, reward, and keep, give a career perspective, data scientists and data experts. I need 20 of them in LUMC, the Leiden University Medical Center, alone. You know, and I have two. But I need many, many more to keep the data fair. So why do we want fair data? I cannot resist to tell you, of course, some of our own research. And sorry that there is biosemantics here, but you will have to translate this to your own field maybe for yourself. So the first thing we always see in e-science is we are so proud we can create great data. And then I stole this term from Larry Hunter, and I deliberately made it very difficult to read here, because how the heck do we see a pattern in this radiculogram? That is our term now for these beautiful pictures that mean absolutely nothing. Unless the computer can see a pattern in it and say, ah, there is always this particular gene that is coming close to a disease and so on. So it's not a matter of making beautiful pictures and larger data, which is just confusing us, okay? But if we get rid of those, we can actually simplify e-science. And of course, I know this is an oversimplification, so attack me on it later. Essentially, we have the research objects like pictures and workflows and everything, and the explicitome. And this is what I call the core legacy of science before. If this was all fair, imagine. Then you create a new data set. And essentially what you want to do as a biologist now or as any researcher, you want to see what is hidden in your data. And therefore you have to make it talk to SwissProt, to Campbell, to the semantic Medline, to everything. And then with the clever workflows, you will get your insights. Essentially, I always use this everywhere as the simplest cartoon of e-science. That's what we want. For this to happen, not only the legacy data should be fair, but also the data I create should be fair, and then they talk to each other. So how do we reach that? And what is the real danger that I see all the time when people develop tools, or articles of the future, or articles without future, or whatever? They have always mixed up what I call the helicopter and the digging. I'm glad you used the digging metaphor, because I use it as well. So this is the aerial survey. You fly very high, you see nothing. But then you zoom in, you go lower, and you zoom into your big data, and here you see a pattern. Now, this could easily be a medieval fortress. You would never see that when you walked into this field, because you would be surrounded by the corn, and you wouldn't see it. That's when you're reading. Reading, forget it nowadays. You know, every gene has 90 papers about it, and so on. So you need to find the pattern in the big data first. You can only do that with a helicopter, or a drone, or anything that flies. You know, that's what I call the aerial survey. And people frequently mix that with digging. So I've done the same thing. We had all these beautiful tools where you highlight everything in text, and then people get completely confused. So what we say, separate the digging from the helicopter. So if you go digging, you would obviously be a very, very bad scientist if you sat in this helicopter. It would say, ah, there is a medieval fortress there. No, you have to prove it. So you go down, but you need completely different tools to do the digging and the brushing and to see how old the stones are and so on. And then you can make a conclusion. So my statement now is, why on earth would I believe an isolated association, including nanopublications? The provenance is the most important thing. You want to dig and know why you would believe that. If you take any statement out of its context, it is useless. Or close to useless. I have to be a little explicit. Most of the things I say, I mean for 80%, okay? So never mix those two. Make tools that are either helicopters or not. This is one example. This is from our graph. I will show more of it later. And the lady asked me in Madrid a few weeks ago, okay, I think SF3B1, the gene here, is involved in breast cancer. There is no direct explicit association in the literature. I put it in the tool. We saw immediately, oh, it's expressed in this particular cell line, and so on. Oh, this makes sense. So then, obviously, the first thing you want to do, we have provenance from the fact that the thing is expressed in the cell line from the human protein atlas, and we saw that this cell line is a specific breast cancer cell line. And we see again in HPA that here on the bottom, gene is hardly expressed in normal tissue, and in breast cancer tissue, it's enormously overexpressed. And then we actually found a paper, a very recent paper, that already said it's at least a biomarker for breast cancer. So we predicted this very clearly before the paper was published, and we have lots of evidence for that. So very quickly, what we did in the past, we did a lot of text mining, and then we made these concept profiles of a million concepts, and we predicted 44,000 novel protein-protein interactions. We tested a few of them, and they were true. And many of them have been now confirmed. So you can predict this very well from the literature, and therefore, I switch with my group to not find explicit stuff, but go for the implicitome, which is implicitly there based on the explicitome. And we recently tried to publish a paper in Nature Genetics twice. Miles came even to Leiden to help us to get it in, but the reviewers don't want it. We predict 180,000 gene disease associations, and we took a decade to get 3,000 in OMIM by hand. And of course, there is 2.4 million billion possibilities. Now, I will give you a very quick overview with a little one movie that is very short, and that's this one. So here, I will explain the graph maybe later, but this is a big graph. And here we were looking at the common genes between metabolic syndrome, Alzheimer's disease, and Parkinson, I think. So you get all the genes involved. And if you now ask the system, add this new thing, metabolic syndrome, and you say, okay, I will now take all the genes that are known to be associated with metabolic syndrome, you just add them all and see what happens. This is a self-organizing cardinal assertion graph. You see the new disease coming in. And it's reading millions of papers for me now, and you see the gene moving, and what you will see is it moves out to form its own nodelet, as we call it. And then, in the end, you will see in the middle a cluster of genes that is involved in all three diseases based over 30 different databases. This will take you years to read, or to mine, or to whatever, but we have done that once. And I'll explain what cardinal assertions are in a minute, but I just wanted to show this movie. This is what I now do every day. It's quite addictive, actually, to get to see how concepts are related in multidimensional concept space. And you can only see these kind of patterns when you go over 30 databases, including Semantic Medline, by the way. So this is the situation of today. And that is very, very different, of course, from only a few years ago. So let me go back to the slides, I hope. So this is, for example, the nodelet of Huntington disease on the left-hand side. That is basically every assertion ever made about Huntington disease. This is a gene, and we predict this gene to be involved in Huntington. But if I ask the lady in our lab to start reading here, the first gene she finds for protein she never heard of, because otherwise she would have known this connection, and we click the provenance and we see 80 papers. Is she going to read? No. And then she has to do 200. So what you really would like to do, and I've been talking to the guys from Microsoft Research to say, can we connect Skype? We have knowledge of people as well. We know what you published about. So the people move in the same graph and you know exactly who to call. That's crowdsourcing. Why is your gene so close to my disease? You may solve it in 5 minutes because the guy has everything, or the lady, in their head. You don't want to read. So we should be in the business of reading avoidance. So what we do now in Leiden, with a company also, it's not a spin-off, but a company we work with, Euritos, we have this coordinated data approach. We make a big cardinal assertion store, which I will explain, and we do all kinds of algorithms to develop new discoveries on that. And one example, Sean Atkins came to us and said, hey, I just read this article that people say that retigabine may work for ALS. And we said in the old version of Brain, that's how it's called, oh, we can rationalize that immediately, that this could be true, as you can see here. And just by adding more data sets meanwhile, and we have a new interface, you see there is a very, very rich graph between reticabine and ALS, and actually they are placed so close in multidimensional space that we would have predicted this years ago, and until things get so close in this space that at some point even people get it. But the computer obviously is much better in spotting these kind of things, like here the association between inflammation and HIV disease progression. And whenever you click on any of these triples, you see the digging here. So the digging is here, the helicopter is there, they are very clearly separated. Don't mix the two. You can also make target dossiers from the graph if people in the pharma want just everything about a particular protein and all the targets, and then you link out. But more interestingly now, I have a guy working on chaos theory in my group, and this is the famous sawtooth that you see in most knowledges, in most phase transitions. And here you see that the red dots are concept pairs, so genes and diseases or proteins, that have not yet been discovered, and the black ones are discovered. And if you look closer, you see that some of the red spots go up over time, and they enter what we now call the knowledge discovery window. And then we start predicting to people, better have a look at those two concepts because they could be related, really biologically, because they get more and more conceptual overlap. So we are now in the process of developing this knowledge discovery window, and what happens is that some concepts move up. That means they are really pulled together. Some concepts move up this way, so they get more conceptual overlap, and their mutual information gets up. Forget the details, it's just to give you an impression of what we are doing. And if you look at concept pairs that are at the very end here, then you see that they have a lot of concepts in common, but it doesn't mean anything. Like it's all gene and genome and human and all these concepts that everything has in common. So you can really now start to predict knowledge discovery. Now, next phase is coming back to this nanopublication stuff. I'm not going to go into depth. People probably know by now it's a single assertion and all the provenance there, and there's many, many, many millions of them now already going around. There is a website, nanopub.org, where you can go and you can see the whole community working on this, and more people are doing this. But the more interesting thing is, if you map these concepts here nicely to UUIDs or persistent identifiers, obviously it's very easy for the computer to detect new statements and existing statements. My favorite old love, malaria. Malaria is transmitted by mosquitoes. You find that over 7,000 times in PubMed alone, that same statement. We need it in the graph only once. So in principle, we can reduce the graph already to 10 to the 11th cardinal assertion. So every assertion is there only once. Obviously, the malaria example has 7,000 provenances to 7,000 databases. And then you see that the number of assertions is skyrocketing. The number of cardinal assertions that you can use for a knowledge discovery graph is much lower. And you see that only a minor part comes from Medline. And if you then cluster them by subject, that's what we call the nolets, we only have a million nolets because we don't publish about more than a million concepts, more or less, in PubMed. That fits on my laptop here, instead of a triple store of 10 to the 14th. And if you take semantic Medline right now from the Library of Medicine, maybe I have the figures not entirely right, but it is roughly like 2.2 billion triples, including all provenance, 65 million unique assertions that they've mined, so they miss a lot, there is a lot more, but that's only done with UMLS. And then if you take the redundancy out, even from semantic Medline, only 8 million triples made it into our graph out of 2.2 billion. So you can do an incredible data reduction. So that is all introduction to a very brief overview of why we need FAIR data. Not a goal in itself, but how do we go there? So we had this meeting a year ago, about, with lots of people coming to Leiden, and we came up with some sort of declaration. And this was really international. George Strawn was there from the NIH, or actually the Intergovernmental Agency. So also in America, the FAIR principle is flying now. And we said, you know, everybody has their own approach to this. We cannot force people to do all the same thing. So we decided we needed the same approach as the internet, where TCP/IP in the middle is a very light protocol, and as long as you stick to that, you're fine. So as long as you stick to a very limited number of guidelines, you can make FAIR data. They can be in Excel, they can be in RDF, they can be in JSON, in XML. We don't enforce a particular ontology. We do not enforce a particular data model. Otherwise, people will not follow because they have their favorite own one and they will not join. So basically we say, as long as you have a PID for each concept used, and we can map it to a PID we know, and we need authorities, and we need an also referred to as service, and we have built that up for more than 40 million concepts by now, they should be accessible. So machines can map it, you have a good license, you know what the authorization and the authentication protocols are, the machine should really understand them, and preferably they can be linked without further ado, and they're actually functionally interlinked, harmonized, and citable, very important. So at the 4C11 website, which is this movement, bottom-up movement to try and change scholarly communication, we have a set of very simple principles. Don't try to read them, just go there and try to stick to them. It's very, very simple. And you can make FAIR data by following these routes. And what we will do more and more is get certified institutions to say this data repository contains FAIR data, yes or no. And that is following a very simple model, which is developed by CNRI, the data digital object. You say you have a PYID for any digital object. You have intrinsic metadata, simply what is it? You can have provenance, you can describe it, annotate it. This could be a single picture, but also the entire SysProt database. And you have the actual data element. That is a very simple model. And now, of course, you can have the architecture can be true for any of the research objects that are described here. But also a nanopublication fits this scheme very well, as you see, but also entire databases. And some code is executable, so workflows also fit under this scheme. And you can then, of course, have a totally unfair data set, which is on the laptop of my PhD student. It doesn't even have a PID, so we cannot even find the data set, which is totally unfair, of course, should be forbidden. Then we have something that at least has a PID, a DOI or whatever. Then you can have FAIR metadata, which is already very useful, and it could be that this is a biobank where the data themselves can never be shared and will never be made FAIR because they are very secret. But still, I want to know there is 5 people in the Netherlands with this mutation and this disease. But I can never go back to the data. And then, of course, you can have full data, and you can have the highest level is that everything is already functionally interlinked in a graph or whatever. And we do that by helping people. We have now bring your own data parties, not bring your own drinks. And here you see, for example, Kalle from the Human Protein Atlas, Mark Wilkinson, and a number of other linked data experts, André Waagmeester, and several others. And in 2 days, we connected Phantom 5 with Wikipathways, with the Human Protein Atlas, and it worked. It is extremely simple. And these things are, we have already had 6 or 7, and they're very popular. People come for 2 days, they get bonding between the data experts and the biologist, and they get something very nicely together. So how can we realize all this? I'm almost done. This is the, you know, one example of a data stewardship cycle. It really already starts with planning your experiment better. Make sure your data are captured with ISOTAP and other standards so that they can be made very easy to curate and to preserve and to integrate. And this is the research cycle. Now, this sounds like expensive. Well, more and more funders, first of all, also the Netherlands, but the UK, but now also the European Commission, is discussing or already requiring 5% of every research grant, roughly, EC is not yet requiring that, for data stewardship. Now, that sounds like, they take that for my research data. Eh? No, you will save 10% by stopping with clumsy data management. So this is going to be a requirement very soon for most funders. You need a work package on data stewardship, and you have to put in there how you deal with your data. And that is not so scary as it looks like, because you can just have lots of centers that know how to do that very soon. And the first European initiative that already sort of did that was the Innovative Medicine Initiative. You look, they spent about $2 billion, and OpenFacts, a project that a lot of this technology was tested in, and I'm part of that, is one of the four projects that collectively consumed about 4% of IMI on data management. That's still a tiny little part with all these other big things. So I think that with this, I would like to sort of summarize and say that if we, what we should really kill is the journal impact factor as a career thing. That's number one. We should really make it criminal to create data without a good data stewardship plan. And we should actually make sure that text mining is not needed anymore in 10 years from now. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.